Part 1, The First Age, Chapter 2, Narnichin Húrin, The Tale of the Children of Húrin, Part 1. Alright, before we take a deep dive into this narrative, let's look at some background information on what's presented. Like the tale of Tuor, Tolkien wrote the tale of Túrin in the 1910s. But, unlike the more detailed version of the Tuor story, the detailed version of the Túrin story is more complete, and that's the version we see here in this book. However, Christopher Tolkien indicates that this story was a very difficult one to organize, because there are big gaps as well as a few overlaps with what appears in the Silmarillion, so I commend his editorial efforts with the deepest respect. He provides an appendix at the end of the chapter where he fills in the gaps, so I'll just be taking those bits and plugging them in wherever they're supposed to go in the main story. This narrative is separated into 13 sections, and it's also the longest story in the book, so buckle up. Section 1, The Childhood of Túrin. So you remember Hador, that leader of the third house of the Edain who Fingolfin gave the entire land of Dor Lomín to? Let's look at his family tree. Hador's daughter and son marry the son and daughter of Halmir of the house of Haleth. So Glorthel, his daughter, marries Haldir, and his son Galdor marries Hareth. Glorthel and Haldir have Handir, who is the father of Brandir. Remember him? Brandir the Lame of Brethil? Yeah, you do. He'll show up later. And Galdor and Hareth have Húrin and Húor. And we know Húrin marries Morwen of the house of Beor, and we know Húor marries Rian, who is also of the house of Beor. She and Morwen are cousins, if you recall. Húrin and Morwen first have a son, Túrin, then they have a daughter, Úrwen, aka Lalaith. And we, of course, know that Húor and Rian have only one child, their son, Tuor. And Lalaith is a happy child, and everyone likes her more than Túrin because he has the stern and dark personality of his mother. He's slow to forgive injustice, and he can be fierce and fiery. However, he also pities the suffering of others. And he loves his mother, but he doesn't see that much of his father, who is often away with Fingon's people guarding Heathloom. And after the disaster of the Dagor Bragollach, the only hope anyone has for victory over Morgoth is when they hear about the heroic deeds of Beren and Lúthien. But Morgoth always has something up his evil sleeve, and when Túrin is 5 years old and Lalaith is 3, a pestilent wind flows down from the north and kills many children of the houses of men, including Lalaith. Túrin gets sick as well, but survives, and when he asks Morwen what happened, she doesn't try to comfort him at all. She just replies, "Úrwen is dead, and laughter is stilled in this house. But you live, son of Morwen, and so does the enemy who has done this to us." Nice. Thanks, Mom. She grieves with silence and coldness of heart, but her husband, Húrin, grieves openly and shakes his fist at the north, yelling, "Marrer of Middle-earth, would that I might see thee face to face and mar thee as my lord Fingolfin did." The only friend that the grieving Túrin confides in is an elderly house servant called Sador, aka Labadal, a former woodsman with a lame foot from an old axe injury. And Sador is kind of like a mentor to Túrin, and he tells him many stories and gives him wisdom and things like that. So a couple years go by, and rumors start to spread of a great mustering of arms, and this would be the Union of Maedhros preparing to launch an attack on Angband. Morwen and Húrin have a conversation about what will happen in the immediate future. Húrin is hopeful in the strength of the elves, but Morwen is more pessimistic. And then one night he has a foreboding dream and afterwards tells her that whatever happens to him, she should not wait for him in Dor Lomín, but instead just escape southwards. And on Túrin's 8th birthday, Húrin gives him an elvish blade. And he's so excited, he runs to tell Sador, and he gives the knife to him as a present. Once his parents find out, Húrin approves of Túrin for having love and pity for Sador. But Morwen doesn't like that. She says, no, you shouldn't have done that. Now you have to wait even longer for another blade. And the day finally comes when all the men of Dor Lómin muster to war. Morwen bids Húrin farewell without tears, saying, I will guard what you leave in my keeping, both what is and what shall be. And of course, we know that she's referring to her pregnancy. And Húrin and his men ride away to the Nirnaitharnöðiad, the Battle of Unnumbered Tears. Section 2. The Words of Húrin and Morgoth. We know that the only warrior of the House of Hador to survive the Nirnaith is Húrin, and Morgoth takes him captive and tortures him. Why? Because Morgoth wants to know where Gondolin is. He tries to tempt Húrin, who instead just mocks him mercilessly. Then Morgoth tries to threaten him by saying he'll hurt Húrin's family. But Húrin says they don't know anything about Gondolin, so torturing them would be a waste of time. Then Morgoth gets angry and curses Húrin and his family. Behold, the shadow of my thought shall lie upon them wherever they go, and my hate shall pursue them to the ends of the world. And Húrin challenges him, though, saying that Morgoth can't govern their movements from afar. And Morgoth replies scornfully, the shadow of my purpose lies upon Arda, and all that is in it bends slowly and surely to my will. But upon all whom you love, my thought shall weigh as a cloud of doom, and it shall bring them into darkness and despair. Wherever they go, evil shall arise. Whenever they speak, their words shall bring ill counsel. Whatever they do shall turn against them. They shall die without hope, cursing both life and death. And Húrin just says, yeah, you've been saying that to everyone for, like, ever. And you act like you're so strong, but you've wasted most of your power on yourself anyway. All that's in store for you is another chain from the Valar. You're not the Lord of Men, and you can't chase anyone beyond the circles of the world. And Morgoth sneers, that's right, because there's nothingness beyond the circles of the world. I have total control over everyone until they pass into nothingness. And Húrin says, you lie! And Morgoth's like, wanna bet? Then he takes Húrin and binds him to a stone chair on top of Thangorodrim, where he can see out to all the lands of Beleriand and everything that happens in them. And as you know, he's stuck there until the day that Morgoth decides to set him free. And Morgoth says to him, look out upon the lands where evil and despair shall come upon those whom you have delivered to me. With my eyes you shall see, and with my ears you shall hear, and nothing shall be hidden from you. Section 3. The Departure of Túrin. During the Nirnaith, the majority of the men of the House of Haleth die, except for three who finally make it back to Brethil. But no news comes to Dor Lómin. We know that Rian goes into the wild, meets up with the elves, hands Tuor over to them, and goes off to die. But Morwen grieves silently at home. We know that she is pregnant during a time of great unrest in Heathloom with the invasion of the Easterlings, and we know how poorly they treat the Edain women, children, and elderly who are still there. However, they don't mess with Morwen because they think she's some sort of witch who has magical dealings with the elves whom they despise. But Morwen is now poor and would starve if not for a woman called Eirin of the House of Hador. She sends Morwen food as well as news. And she's able to do this because Brada the Easterling took her as his wife by force and stole a bunch of land and food from the Edain while enslaving them as well. And even though the Easterlings don't actually know that Túrin exists, Morwen worries about him as time goes by. She thinks about sending him away to be fostered by Thingol in Doriath, but she chooses not to go with him for a couple reasons. One, she's about to give birth and the road is difficult. Two, she's still hopeful that Húrin will return, even though he told her not to wait for him. And three, her pride will not let her go to Thingol's house to live as a charity case, even if he is a king. But this decision not to go with Turin immediately will prove to be one in a long chain of unfortunate circumstances leading to the family's doom. So Morwen tells Turin that she's sending him away so that he won't grow up to be a slave of the Easterlings. And he doesn't even know what a slave is, and he doesn't understand why she won't just go with him. So he's really, really sad, and he asks if Sador can come with him, but she says no, because Sador is lame and he wouldn't make it. Then he goes to talk to Sador and find some consolation, and Sador explains to him what a slave is and that he needs to leave Dor Lomín so he'll be safe and continue the line of the lords of the House of Hador. And he tries to give Turin back the knife, but Turin refuses. And the day finally comes when Turin leaves his mother and Dor Lomín. He's only 9 years old, and this is his first real sorrow in life. And not long afterwards, Morwen gives birth to a daughter whom she names Nienor, which means mourning. After a while, braving the dangerous wild, Turin and his two guides finally make it to the borders of Doriath, where they might just die of hunger and exhaustion if it weren't for Beleg. Yes, they meet Beleg Strongbow, because he lives and hunts on the borders of the realm. And he takes an immediate liking to Turin. He seems like a good kid. So, with Thingol and Melian's permission, Beleg leads the three travelers to Menegroth. And Thingol gives Turin a royal welcome, because the elves hold his father Hurin in high esteem, and because he's a kinsman of Beren. And Thingol then fosters him, and states that he should be treated as though he were Thingol's own son, which is absolutely unheard of at the time. So that's not half bad, huh? For a welcome? So after a while, one of Turin's guardian companion guides dies, and the other one returns to Dor Lomín, with an escort of elves from Doriath. And the escort gives a message to Morwen that Turin arrived safely, and they really try to convince her to come back with them, but she still refuses. She's still prideful. And when they finally do get back to Doriath, Turin is very, just deeply saddened and disappointed that his mother didn't arrive with the escort. And so this is his second sorrow in life. However, Morwen has given the elves the helm of Hador to bring to Thingol. That helm was made of gray steel adorned with gold, and on it were graven runes of victory. Upon its crest was set in defiance a gilded image of the head of Glaurung, the dragon. Now this helmet protects whoever wears it, and it gives hope to people on the battlefield while striking fear in the hearts of its enemies. It was made by a dwarf mastersmith from Nogrod for the dwarf lord Azaghal of Belagost. He was slain during the Nirnaeth, if you remember that. Anyway, a long time ago, Azaghal gave it to Maedhros when Maedhros saved his life. And then Maedhros gave it to Fingon because besties. But in all the land of Heathloom, no one was strong enough to wear this crazy big helmet, except for Hador and his son Galdor. So, Fingon gave it to Hador when he became Lord of Dor Lomín. And now Thingol has it. But Thingol figures, hey, why don't I just give it to Turin? So he summons the kid and says, now take the dragon head of the north, and when the time comes, wear it well. Section 4. Turin in Doriath. So Melian is the one who watches over Turin as he grows up in Doriath, but she's more hands-off about it. So instead of taking care of him directly, she has an elf called Nedlas serve as his guardian and tutor of sorts. Nedlas teaches Turin how to speak the variety of Sindarin that they speak in Doriath, which is more archaic and poetic. And he will always speak with a Doriath accent, even into adulthood. But as he grows older and older, he doesn't seek her out anymore, and she doesn't ever come to Menegroth where he lives, instead preferring the open woods over halls of stone. She doesn't like being indoors. And Turin lives in Menegroth for 9 years, And during that time, he exchanges periodic messages with Morwen whenever Thingol sends messengers out. And he learns that his sister is growing up well and that his mother is doing better now that she knows he's okay. And Beleg starts to hang out with him a lot and teaches him how to live in the wild and use weapons and fight, things like that. But Turin isn't very good at craftsmanship because he's slow to learn his own strength. He often ends up breaking things by accident. It seemed that fortune was unfriendly to him, so that often what he designed went awry, and what he desired he did not gain. He is a rather dark and stoic person who doesn't make friends very easily, although he is well-loved by those close to him who actually know him. And of course, he occupies a place of high honor as Thingol's foster son. However, there's one guy who really doesn't like him, and he's called Cyros. He is a Nandor elf who sought refuge in Doriath after the first battle of Beleriand. And he holds a pretty high rank and has the esteem of the king. But he's really haughty and arrogant, and he's a total jerk. And he does not like humans at all, let me tell you. He talks down to Túrin whenever he has the chance, but Túrin usually just ignores him because he just sees him as an annoying person. One day, when Túrin turns 17, there comes a time when all messages stop coming in from Dor Lómin because Morgoth has put it, he started to put a tight watch on the borders of Heathloom. And this upsets Túrin greatly because he worries about his family and his people and the future of the House of Hador. So he goes to Thingol and asks for armor, weapons, and the dragon helm to go out and fight the enemy. Thingol says he'll send him to guard the marches of Doriath, but Túrin wants to go beyond to fight Morgoth head-on. And Thingol and Melian tell him that, well, okay, no one's stopping him, but they're not going to send any elves to fight with him. And then they counsel him just to stick around in Doriath until he has finally grown up. Like, they don't think that's a good idea to try to go out and fight Morgoth alone at all. So he takes the weapons and whatnot and goes to the borders of Doriath to join the elf warriors there, who must constantly go out and battle with orcs and other servants of darkness. And he proves himself in strength and bravery. I mean, he's really great. And the only person who really is stronger and more skillful in battle is Beleg. And they become the best of friends. So Túrin spends 3 years doing this really difficult work, and he kind of stops caring about his appearance. He's got a beard, disheveled hair. He kind of looks like a wild person. And at one point, he needs some weapon repair and a little bit of rest. So he goes back to Menegroth, you know, looking like a crazy woodsman or whatever. And keep in mind, the king and queen are on vacation somewhere else right now, so they're not at home. And he walks into the great hall, and he's really lost in his thought. He just absentmindedly sits down at a table with a bunch of high-ranking elves, and they welcome him gladly, of course. But when Cyros walks in to sit down, he sees that Túrin is sitting there in his seat, and he thinks Túrin did it on purpose just to make him mad. But that's not true. He's not even thinking about what he's doing. So Cyros sits across from him and tries to annoy him with sarcasm and mockery. But since Túrin is so preoccupied in his own dark and worried thoughts about his family, he doesn't say anything. But his silence makes Cyros even angrier. So he eventually gets up and throws a comb at Túrin, basically saying, "Here's a brush, use it!" And Túrin looks up with a glare that should have been a warning. But Cyros keeps going, saying, "If the men of Heathloom are so wild-looking, I can't imagine what their women are like. You think they just run around with nothing but their hair covering them? Ooh, bad move." Túrin gets up and throws a cup squarely at Cyros' face, making him fall down and kind of bleed. And just as he starts to draw his sword, Mablung restrains him. And Cyros yells at him, saying, "It's illegal to attack someone in the king's hall." And Turin just turns around and leaves the room. He just disengages completely. And Mablung scolds Syros and warns him that he'd better watch out. This sort of behavior comes from Morgoth, and it's certainly not fit for an elf. And the next morning, as Turin sets out again to go back to the marches, he's had enough of Menegroth, Syros runs at him with a sword from behind. But Turin saw him coming and dodges him. Then they fight for a bit until Turin gets the upper hand, and in a callback to Syros's insult from the night before, Turin tells him, "There is a long race before you, and clothes will be a hindrance. Hair must suffice." So he strips Syros of all of his clothing and forces him to run through the forest naked as he chases him. And Syros is absolutely terrified, and he thinks Turin is going to kill him. And other elves, including Mablung, run after the two. They didn't see the whole thing, though. They still think that Turin is doing this unprovoked out of nowhere. And they don't know that Syros was the one to attack first. Well, when Syros tries to jump across a deep stream, he slips and falls to his death. And Turin is thinking at this point, "Oh no, I just wanted to scare him, not kill him." And Mablung says, "Okay, you have to go back to Menegroth for judgment from the king." But Turin fears the possibility of being held captive, so he decides, "No, I'm just going to leave Doriath forever. Bye-bye." And meanwhile, Beleg at some point goes to Menegroth, thinking Turin is still there, but he's troubled once he finds out everything that's happened. And then Thingol and Melian eventually return, and Thingol needs to pronounce a judgment on all that's happened, so he gathers his counselors together, and they go through all the evidence. And he decides that everything that happened in the hall at the table is Syros's fault, but he doesn't pardon Turin for shaming and chasing Syros through the woods to his death. He states that because of this, Turin is ungrateful, too proud for his own good, and willfully broke the king's laws, and thus he is no longer Thingol's son unless he comes back and begs for forgiveness. Thingol says he will banish Turin from Doriath, and asks before he makes his final judgment if there's anyone who objects to this. And, just then, Beleg comes in and says, "Wait, I've got one final witness." And that witness is Nellas. She just happened to be sitting high up in a tree when she saw the whole thing. She tells Thingol how Syros was the attacker and meant to kill Turin, but that when Turin bested him, he showed mercy to him when he could have just killed him. So Thingol pronounces Turin pardoned and still welcome in Doriath. But Nellas tells him that, hey, Turin's gone. He left. And Thingol says he will send people to find him. And the next day, Thingol tells Beleg that he really hopes no one's gonna say that he drove Turin away unjustly from his halls, because he still loves him as a son and would gladly welcome him if he returned. And Beleg says, "Okay, fine, I'll go out and find him and bring him back, because, you know, I love him too." So Beleg searches throughout the wild all of autumn, winter, and spring, but he still doesn't find Turin.